The topic this morning, and really the title of my book, is God's Word Alone, which is, you can guess, has to do with Sola Scriptura, that Reformation slogan that was so critical in the 16th century. However, I've titled my message something different in order to personalize it for you at this conference. And so the title of my message this morning is Sola Scriptura in the Strange Land of Evangelicalism. And my subtitle is The Peculiar but Necessary Responsibility of Defending Sola Scriptura Against Our Own Kind. So I will flesh out what this long Puritan-like title means throughout this presentation. So what if everything in the Bible isn't true and reliable and from God? That doesn't really matter, does it? The Bible, after all, still remains the authority in my life. Though it's been years now, I remember hearing these words from someone I knew and just being shocked. They were simply shocking to hear. Honestly, I had no idea what to say. I was speechless, quite literally. My shock was very hard to get over. To begin with, I was shocked that I was hearing these words from someone who was a church-going, Bible-carrying, evangelical Christian. But I was also shocked that this individual saw absolutely no relation between the truthfulness of Scripture and the authority of Scripture, as if one had nothing to do with the other. In that moment, there were really two realizations that hit me very hard. First, I realized that the Reformation doctrine of Sola Scriptura is just as important today as it was in the 16th century. Now, perhaps that sounds a little melodramatic, but actually I think it's on target. In the 16th century, the Reformers faced an enormous opponent in Rome, because Rome elevated tradition and its magisterium to the level of Scripture in terms of authority. Nevertheless, Rome still believed Scripture itself was inspired by God and therefore inerrant. Since the 16th century Reformation, however, Protestantism and its view of the Bible has really undergone an evolution, we could call it, in its identity due to movements like the Enlightenment, liberalism, and more recently, postmodernism. The result is astounding. Not only have other voices been elevated to the level of Scripture, or even above Scripture, you think of reason with the Enlightenment, or experience with liberalism, and subjectivism or relativism with postmodernism. But the inspiration and inerrancy of Scripture have been abandoned in the process as well, something Rome in the 16th century would not have done. That the Bible is God-breathed and truthful in all that it asserts is no longer believed to be the case. Still, the situation gets much worse. This changing attitude toward the Bible has originated not only from those outside the walls of the church, but also from those within. As Carl Henry pointed out in his magnum opus, God, Revelation, and Authority, the church throughout history has faced repeated attacks on the Bible from skeptics. But only in the 19th century and the 20th century has the truthfulness and trustworthiness of God's Word now been questioned, criticized, and abandoned by those within the body of Christ. To the Reformers, this would have been unthinkable. And yet, this is the day you and I live in. Not only do Bible critics pervade the culture, but now they have mounted pulpits and they sit comfortably in pews. So accustomed have churches become to such a mentality within the church that sometimes it's no longer shocking for church-going, Bible-carrying, evangelical Christians even to voice criticisms of the very Bible they claim to live by. I saw proof of this in my casual conversation, a conversation that left me just grasping for words. If Carl Henry is right, and I think he is, then certainly there is a legitimate cause for alarm. Repeated attacks on Scripture's own character not only say volumes about the spiritual air we breathe, but more fundamentally, they reveal the enmity and the hostility toward the God of the Bible within our own souls. Therefore, one of the most significant needs in the 21st century, I believe, is a call back to the Bible, and one that demands reverence, acceptance, and adherence to its authority and its message. But there was a second corresponding realization that hit me hard that day. I realized that most Christians in the church have no idea what Sola Scriptura means or what it entails. Most Christians, or many we could say, don't have a clue what the authority of the Bible has to do with attributes like inspiration, inerrancy, and sufficiency. While many understand that Sola Scriptura means that the Bible is our final authority, they may have no idea why exactly. Is it just because this is the best way to live life in the church? Is it just because the Bible is the best quality guidebook that we can come by? Or is there a more fundamental, a more biblical reason as to why the Bible is to have the final say? It's this last question that brings us really to the very center of the formal principle of the Reformation. It's this question that might help us recover biblical authority for today. So what I want to do as we move forward in our time here are really three things. First, I want to briefly, just very briefly, return to the 16th century in order to understand Luther's stance on Sola Scriptura. I would love to cover all the reformers, but we will limit ourselves to Luther. And then secondly, I want to turn from Luther and seek to define Sola Scriptura and what it entails, and look at some of its core components. And then last, which is where we will spend most of our time, third, I'm going to turn to address two pressing challenges that I believe will actually be very relevant for many of you, especially if you're a seminary student here today, very relevant. We're going to look to some of these challenges, two in particular, to Sola Scriptura today, challenges that I don't know that the Reformers could have ever anticipated. So let's begin with Martin Luther and his captivity to the Word of God. Historians have often pointed back to Luther's 95 Theses as perhaps the critical moment, the genesis of the Reformation, maybe. But in terms of the development of Sola Scriptura, the debates Luther engaged in after posting those theses are really what proved to be critical. I want you to travel back in time and consider briefly several debates that Luther engaged in. First, consider Luther's conflict with Sylvester Prierius, a Dominican theologian appointed by Leo X to respond to Luther's 95 Theses. This is very early on. He wrote in his dialogue concerning the power of the Pope. Listen to what he says here. This is so telling. "He who does not accept the doctrine of the Church of Rome and the Pontiff of Rome as an infallible rule of faith, from which the Holy Scriptures too draw their strength and authority, is a heretic." Luther responded by pointing out that Prierius cited no scripture to prove his case. "Instead, like an insidious devil, you pervert the scriptures." Very Luther-like. Luther then exposed the corruptions and contradictions that he believed he saw in the papacy, one that Prierius considered to be infallible. And though papal infallibility would not be declared official dogma until the First Vatican Council in 1870, Prierius' response to Luther shows how many believed the Pope was infallible and inerrant whenever he spoke ex cathedra. As Luther's, one of Luther's biographers, there are many, but one of them said, "Not only were the Roman Church and the Pope infallible, but the authority of the Church, it stood explicitly above that of the Scriptures, even authorizing the Scriptures." So there you get a little bit of a taste and a flavor for Rome. Luther, of course, disagreed, not only appealing to Scripture's authority, but he also appealed to Augustine's letter to Jerome, where the former elevates Scripture's authority, emphasizing that the Bible alone is inspired by God and without error. Or consider next Luther's encounter with the Dominican Cardinal Cajetan, perhaps one of the most, if not the most, impressive Catholic theologians in Luther's day. In October of 1518, Luther engages him after this imperial diet of Augsburg, and an argument between the two lasts for days as Luther is commanded that he must recant what he has said. Luther, of course, won't do it. When Cajetan confronted Luther with Pope Clement VI, his bull, Unigenitus, from 1343 in the 14th century, this, by the way, was a declaration that affirmed the merits of Christ are a treasure of indulgences. Luther eventually rejected it, as well as the Pope's authority. He said, "I am not so audacious that for the sake of a single obscure and ambiguous decretal of a human pope, I would recede from so many and such clear testimonies of divine scripture. For, as one of the canon lawyers has said, in a matter of faith, not only is a council above a pope, but any one of the faithful, if armed with a better authority and reason." In other words, Luther's point here is to show, in contrast to Cajetan, where authority lies. When Cajetan responded that Scripture must be interpreted by the Pope, who is above not only councils, but Scripture itself, Luther replied, "His Holiness abuses Scripture. I deny that he is above Scripture." But perhaps Luther's greatest challenge would come in 1519 at the Leipzig debate with the Catholic disputant Johannes von Eck. Eck brought the central issue to the table. And this really is perhaps the pivotal moment in which Luther comes to grips with what his views entail. Who has final authority? God's Word or the Pope? For Eck, Scripture received its authority from the Pope. Luther strongly disagreed, arguing instead that Scripture has authority over popes, church fathers, and even church councils, all of which, he said, have erred in the past. Moreover, said Luther, not only is Scripture our only infallible authority, but a schoolboy with Scripture in his hand is better fortified than the Pope himself. I think we need to pause in the middle of this epic debate so that we don't miss the obvious, as sometimes historians and theologians do. And what is that? For Luther, Sola Scriptura was entirely connected to what we today would call the inerrancy of Scripture. Now, granted, Luther didn't use the term inerrancy. Nonetheless, the concept, the idea itself, is present throughout his thought. And you see it come up in these debates. If Scripture is not inerrant, then Sola Scriptura, for Luther, is without foundation. What made the Bible alone the supreme authority was that it was not only inspired by God, but as a result of being God-breathed, the Scriptures and the Scriptures alone could not and do not err. On the other hand, church councils and popes can and do err. In other words, while Rome believed Scripture and tradition were inerrant authorities, Luther argued that Scripture alone is our inerrant authority from God. As Luther would state in his 1521 treatise, The Misuse of the Mass, "Since the fathers have often erred, as you yourself confess, who will make us certain as to where they have not erred, assuming their own reputation is sufficient and should not be weighed and judged according to the Scriptures? What if they erred in their interpretation as well as in their life and writings? And that way you make gods of all that is human in us and of men themselves." And listen to what he says next. "And the word of man you make equal to the word of God. The saints could err in their writings and the sin in their lives. But the Scriptures? The Scriptures cannot err." Elsewhere, Luther would argue that the fathers have erred as men will. "Therefore, I am ready to trust them only when they give me evidence for their opinions from the Scripture, which has never erred." Luther goes on to then quote Augustine. And he says, I have learned to do only those books that are called the Holy Scriptures, the honor of believing firmly that none of their writings have ever erred. And so Luther concludes, Scripture alone is the true Lord and Master of all writings and doctrine on earth. There you see his elevation of its authority. So I think it seems abundantly clear that Luther not only affirmed what we today would call the inerrancy of Scripture, at least in its core components, but believed inerrancy was very much a corollary to sola scriptura, a necessary component to biblical inspiration and authority. While Rome believed Scripture and tradition were not only inspired but inerrant and therefore authoritative, Luther protested that God's word alone was the church's flawless authority. To deny this, Luther believed, was to reject the sola of sola scriptura. It was to make the teachings of men equal to the word of God, as if they too were not only God-breathed, but without error. Well, everything came to a head in 1521 when Luther was summoned to the Diet of Worms for an imperial diet before Charles V. On April 17th, a great crowd gathered for the event, and Luther's publications were set out onto a table, and he was asked whether he would stand by his writings or whether he would recant them. Luther did not take this moment lightly, and he feared that he might speak too rashly, which could do harm to God's word or put his own soul or the souls of others in jeopardy. So Luther asked for time to think about his answer. And after thinking this matter through, Luther returned the next day, and this time he spoke with boldness. Unless I am convinced by the testimony of the Scriptures or by clear reason, for I do not trust either in the Pope or in councils alone, since it is well known that they often err and contradict themselves, I am bound by the Scriptures I have quoted, and my conscience is captive to the Word of God. I cannot and I will not recant anything. Since it is neither safe nor right to go against conscience, I cannot do otherwise. Here I stand. May God help me. Amen. While popes and councils contradict each other and therefore err, Scripture, says Luther, Scripture alone does not err. Scripture, Luther believed, is the normy norm rather than the determined or the ruled norm. It is apparent, I think, that at Worms, Luther rejected what was called the two-source theory. I won't go into it in detail here, but I do in my book. The two-source theory, which viewed oral tradition as a second extra-biblical and inerrant source of divine revelation passed down from the apostles to the magisterium. While Luther greatly valued, as I hope you can see in these quotes, where he appeals to Augustine. He greatly valued those fathers and councils that defended orthodoxy. He argued that Scripture alone is our infallible source of divine revelation. Now, can we come away from this all too brief look at Luther with a definition of sola scriptura? I think so. For Luther and the Reformers, sola scriptura meant that only Scripture, because it is God's inspired word, only Scriptures are inerrant, sufficient, and final authority for the church. Perhaps the best way to unpack this definition is to actually start at the end and work backwards. So follow me as we do that. Notice, first of all, that sola scriptura means that Scripture alone is our final authority. Authority is a bad word in our day, isn't it? Authority is something that's looked down upon in our day of rugged individualism. But the Bible is all about authority. In fact, sola scriptura means that the Bible is our chief, supreme, and it's our ultimate authority. The sharp listener will notice, though, that I didn't say the Bible is the exclusive authority in existence. Sola scriptura is too easily confused today with nuda scriptura, a view that likes to sing no creed but the Bible, something that Carl referenced yesterday briefly in his look at some of the radical reformers. Those who sing this mantra not only believe that the Bible is their final authority, but the only authority. And as a result, creeds, confessions, and voices of tradition, those who hold ecclesiastical offices in the church, have no authority. But this is not the reformers' position. nor should it be confused or equated with Sola Scriptura. Instead, Sola Scriptura acknowledges, yes, there are other important authorities for the Christian, authorities that should be listened to and even obeyed. Nonetheless, Scripture is our final authority. It is the authority that rules over and governs all other authorities. It is the authority that has the final say. A clever way to put this taxonomy is to say that while church tradition and church officials play a ministerial role, Scripture alone plays a magisterial role. And therefore, all other authorities are only to be followed in as much as they align with Scripture, submit to Scripture, and are seen as subservient to Scripture, which alone is our supreme authority. Second, Sola Scriptura means that Scripture alone is our sufficient authority. Simply put, Scripture is enough. Not only is the Bible our supreme authority, but it is the authority that provides the believer with all the truth he or she needs for salvation and for following after Christ. The Bible, therefore, is sufficient for faith and practice. As Paul says in a beautiful passage in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17, we usually note this passage for its affirmation of inspiration, but we can't miss the second half of it. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Or consider the 1561 Belgic Confession. We believe that those holy Scriptures fully contain the will of God, and that whatsoever man ought to believe unto salvation is sufficiently taught therein. Third, Sola Scriptura means that only Scripture, because it is God's inspired word, is our inerrant authority. Notice, first of all, that the basis of biblical authority, the very reason why Scripture is authoritative, is that God is its divine author. In other words, the ground for biblical authority is divine inspiration. The Westminster Confession puts this precisely. It says, "The authority of the Holy Scripture, for which it ought to be believed and obeyed, dependeth not upon the testimony of any man or church, but wholly upon God, who is truth itself, the author thereof, and therefore it is to be received." Why? Because it is the Word of God. Scripture is the church's final and sufficient authority, first and foremost, because Scripture is the Word of God. Scripture, and Scripture alone, not Scripture and tradition, is God-breathed. As Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:16, all Scripture is breathed out by God. Peter says something similar in 2 Peter 1:20 through 21. No prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man. But men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. It's on the basis of verbal, plenary inspiration that the Bible stands unshakable as the church's final, flawless authority. What Scripture says, God says. However, we must address more than inspiration to grasp a full picture of Sola Scriptura and what it entails. To say that the Bible is God-breathed inspiration should lead you to say, in your very next breath, that the Bible is perfect, flawless, and inerrant. In other words, inerrancy is a necessary corollary of inspiration. They're really two sides of the same coin, impossible to divorce from one another. Because it is God speaking, and He undoubtedly is a God of truth, not error. His word, His speech must be true and trustworthy in everything that it addresses. If it is not, naturally, we would begin to question whether the Scriptures are really God-breathed after all. God's word, in other words, his speech, his words, they reflect who he is, his very character even. So Scripture is rightly referred to as the word of God. This is why Scripture can identify the words of Scripture with God himself. Should his words prove false, untrue, mistaken, that is a reflection on him. But should his words prove true, that is a reflection of his trustworthiness. As Psalm 18:30 says, "This God, his way is perfect." And notice what it says next. "The word of the Lord proves true." It's precisely because inerrancy is a biblical corollary and a consequence of divine inspiration, inseparably connected and intertwined, that it really is, therefore, a key and necessary component to Sola Scriptura, even if inerrancy isn't the only component or sufficient in and of itself for our doctrine of Sola Scriptura. The God of truth has breathed out his word of truth, and the result is nothing less than a flawless authority for the church. Now, I expect it's the inclusion of inerrancy in our definition and what it entails of Sola Scriptura that will prove most controversial, given the mixed identity of evangelicalism today. I'm convinced, though, that should we divorce the truthfulness and trustworthiness of Scripture from its authority, disconnecting the two, as if one was unrelated to the other, then we will be left with no doctrine of Sola Scriptura at all. John Frame has said, if there are errors, then it's unclear why we should look to Scripture as our supreme divine authority. And, I would add, should we limit, modify, or abandon total inerrancy, we set in motion tremendous doubt and uncertainty regarding the Bible's competence as our final authority. The grounds that we stand on for our confidence that all of Scripture is the Word of God will be shaken if this happens. Now, we could spend our entire time on each aspect of this definition. And if my book does just that. It not only gives a historical treatment, but it also gives a biblical theology of God's Word, as well as a systematic theological treatment of each of the attributes of Scripture. But we don't have time. So, you might have noticed that the subtitle for each of these books in this series is the five sola series, what the Reformers taught, but doesn't stop there, does it? What the Reformers taught and why it still matters. It's the second half of this phrase that is especially important because in the 21st century, Sola Scriptura is facing new challenges. Challenges that the Reformers, I don't think, could have even anticipated. Nevertheless, they are challenges that we must answer and you must answer if you are going to have a chance of retaining the formal principle for the next generation. And so I want to focus on just two challenges that I believe are especially relevant and concerned about your own soul you might be tempted to adopt as an evangelical. Number one, and we're going to spend most of our time on this first challenge. Number one, the challenge to Sola Scriptura from limited inerrantist evangelicals. In my research, I have found myself very surprised. In all the treatments of Sola Scriptura, very few address the question, what does inerrancy have to do with Sola Scriptura? In other words, while many treatments do a wonderful job of addressing authority, inspiration, inerrancy, and sufficiency individually, rarely do you come across one that tries to connect the dots between all of these. Rarely does someone ask, well, what do these attributes have to do with Sola Scriptura precisely? Sola Scriptura, since the Reformation, has come under fire by new opponents. And to understand how, I want to take you back to the Reformation era. The 16th century reformers, remember, they opposed Rome because she questioned the sufficiency and authority of Scripture by elevating tradition, believing it to be divine revelation, just as authoritative as Scripture itself. As a result, the distinctiveness and the uniqueness of biblical truthfulness and inerrancy was challenged in the sense that Rome claimed there was a second source of divine revelation that was also inerrant, tradition. Now, to be clear, I'm not saying that Rome opposed the inerrancy of Scripture. She affirmed it. At that time, at least. Rather, the point is that Rome's elevation of tradition as a second inerrant source of revelation was perceived by the Reformers as a major threat to the exclusivity and uniqueness of Scripture as the sole inerrant source of written revelation and final authority for the church. The consequence was devastating. When Rome claimed tradition to be inerrant and not just Scripture, no longer could Scripture be sufficient an authority in and of itself. For Rome, tradition was equally authoritative because it was considered not only revelatory but inerrant. In this sense, then, Rome's elevation of tradition to the level of inerrancy had significant consequences for the denial of Scripture, scriptural sufficiency, and final authority. But the situation would become much worse with the advent of the Enlightenment and then liberalism and eventually postmodernism. The very trustworthiness and truthfulness of the Bible itself was now being brought into question, something Rome, at least in the 16th century, was not willing to do. History demonstrates that all too often when Scripture's trustworthiness is rejected, it's not long before Scripture's sufficiency and authority is abandoned as well. After all, critics often saw no reason why they should believe the Bible was authoritative when that same Bible was not inspired by God, but was errant in numerous ways. In other words, there could be no "thus says the Lord" when the Lord didn't really speak, and the text that says he did speak was errant to begin with. It made little sense to believe the biblical text was authoritative in what it addressed and asserted when the same biblical text was believed to be errant or uninspired in part or, in some cases, in total. Whenever this thinking took root, Sola Scriptura was seriously questioned and threatened as a result. Of course, this approach to Scripture still continues today. Nevertheless, what makes our day so unique, particularly in the world of evangelicalism, is that some try to pave a middle way by holding on to a biblical authority and sufficiency while simultaneously denying biblical inerrancy. In other words, while there are those who have abandoned the concept of inerrancy completely, others are just as dissatisfied but are not willing to dispense with the term or the idea in some sense. While the limited inerrantist position, that's what I'm calling it here, may take on a variety of forms due to its diverse group of advocates, essentially this view argues that there are errors in Scripture, but when it comes to the Bible's central spiritual message, there are not. Limited inerrancy advocates are eager to maintain that while Scripture may not be perfect in all its details, especially those of historical or cosmological nature, or even in every subject matter it addresses, nevertheless, it's trustworthy in its message, its main message, and therefore the Bible remains authoritative and sufficient. Notice for our purposes that advocates of limited inerrancy do not necessarily believe their view precludes the doctrine of Sola Scriptura. Rather, in their view, the two remain mutually compatible. We don't have time to explore the history of this view, but this viewpoint, more or less, was taken by progressive neo-evangelicals at Fuller Seminary in the 1960s, who denied Scripture's full inerrancy, yet insisted that Scripture remains the Christian's final authority. Such an approach not only continues to pervade the academic world today, but it also infiltrated church pews, as my anecdote at the start revealed. But I want to argue in our time here that such a view is riddled with inconsistency. In other words, whether one realizes it or not, to question Scripture's reliability is to also question Scripture's sufficiency and its authority. As mentioned, these attributes are intertwined with one another, inseparable and essential to the existence of each other. To put this plainly, one cannot consistently affirm and practice Sola Scriptura while abandoning inerrancy. These two doctrines are mutually dependent upon one another. Indeed, it is because all of Scripture is verbally inspired by God, and therefore necessarily without error, that it carries final and ultimate authority and is fully sufficient. To begin with, we must return to the Reformation to gain some of their insight and wisdom. What was the crux of the issue? Do you remember for the Reformers when it came to Sola Scriptura? If we think back to our narrative of Luther's progress to the Diet of Worms, the issue of Sola Scriptura rested in part, at least, if not in a very significant sense, it rested on who does and does not err. As we saw in Luther's debates, Luther strongly believed that what set Scripture apart in terms of authority was not only its divine inspiration, but specifically its absolute perfection and flawlessness, much in contrast to the imperfection of the ecclesiastical tradition. In other words, Luther believed Scripture alone is our flawless authority. For Luther, observes R.C. Sproul, the sola of Sola Scriptura was inseparably related to the Scripture's unique inerrancy. It was because popes could and did err, and because councils could and did err, that Luther came to realize the supremacy of Scripture. Luther did not despise church authority, nor did he repudiate church councils as having no value. Luther and the Reformers did not mean by Sola Scriptura that the Bible is the only authority in the church. Rather, they meant that the Bible is the only infallible authority in the church. In other words, it is precisely because God's word is God-breathed and therefore inerrant, God does not breathe out air, that it possesses unconditional and final authority. To put it bluntly, Sola Scriptura means that the Bible alone is our flawless authority. This simply cannot, and it should not, ever be said of anything else. The Bible alone is the inerrant source of written revelation from God. As Luther believed so emphatically, since church councils, fathers, and yes, even popes err, they cannot possess an equal authority to Scripture. Their authority is contingent upon their faithfulness to the biblical text, which alone is inspired and inerrant. At best, they possess a derivative authority. Where they are consistent with Scripture, they can speak authoritatively. As Luther himself said, "But everyone indeed knows that at times they, the fathers, have erred as men will. Therefore, I am ready to trust them only when they prove their opinions from Scripture, which has never erred." I think the way we could summarize this is to say the Reformers, in an important sense, considered inerrancy, the truthfulness of Scripture, to be a corollary to Sola Scriptura. While some, like Jack Rogers and Donald McKim, have popularized the myth that inerrancy was an invention of Reformed scholasticism, or perhaps old Princeton, John Woodbridge has done a terrific job of exploding this myth, demonstrating not only that inerrancy was taught by the Reformers, but it has a heritage that goes all the way back to the fathers. And it's in that light that I think it's terribly important to include inerrancy in our explanation and defense of Sola Scriptura today. As our definition of Sola Scriptura reads, Sola Scriptura means that only Scripture, because it is God's inspired word, is our inerrant, sufficient, and final authority for the church. But it's not just the Reformers who have seen this connection between inerrancy and biblical authority. The Reformed tradition at large has followed suit. Just consider a few examples with me. The Belgic Confession calls Scripture the infallible rule for the church, a statement that combines both Scripture's perfection and its authority in one phrase. Or consider the Church of England, whose 39 articles assert that councils may err and sometimes have erred, even in things pertaining to unto God. In contrast, the assumption here is that Scripture alone is God's inspired word that does not err, and so it stands supreme in its authority over councils. Or the Westminster Confession of Faith. It states that the infallible rule of interpretation of Scripture is the Scripture itself. And by infallible, the Puritans did not mean something less than inerrancy, as limited inerrantists do today. Therefore, the confession states, as the infallible rule, it alone is the supreme judge. Or, for us Baptists. The London Baptist Confession, which is largely based on the Westminster Confession, is just as explicit. The Holy Scripture, it says, is the only sufficient, certain, and infallible rule of all saving knowledge, faith, and obedience. Reformed theologians and councils today also see inerrancy as essential to our definition and our defense and articulation of Sola Scriptura. One of the best examples of this comes from the Chicago Statement on Inerrancy from 1978. I want you to listen here to several statements I'm going to read from this, from the Chicago Statement, and notice how they connect authority and its supremacy to inspiration and inerrancy. Recognition of the total truth and trustworthiness of Holy Scripture is essential to a full grasp and adequate confession of its authority. Holy Scripture, being God's own word, written by men, prepared and superintended by his Spirit, is of infallible divine authority in all matters upon which it touches. The authority of Scripture is inescapably impaired if this total divine inerrancy is in any way limited or disregarded. And last, great and grave confusion results from ceasing to maintain the total truth of the Bible, whose authority one professes to acknowledge. The result of taking this step is that the Bible, which God gave, loses its authority. And what has authority instead is a Bible reduced in content according to the demands of one's critical reasonings, and in principle reducible still further once one has started. More recently, this explicit inclusion of inerrancy in an articulation of Sola Scriptura was also affirmed by the Cambridge Declaration in the 90s, signed by a host of today's leading evangelical thinkers, all part of the Alliance of Confessing Evangelicals. Toward the start of this declaration, we read this: Scripture alone is the inerrant rule of the church's life, and we reaffirm the inerrant Scripture to be the sole source of written divine revelation, which alone can bind the conscience. Sounds much like Luther. With these definitions in mind, it would have been unthinkable in ages past to say that Scripture is authoritative but not inerrant. For those who have come out of the Reformation heritage, one necessarily includes the other and is assumed in the other. To deny inerrancy would have meant rejecting biblical authority as well. After all, how can we trust and submit to the authority of the Bible if we don't believe it's fully true? Our knowledge is derivative of the Scriptures. So should we limit or abandon Scripture's trustworthiness, we inevitably bring down the entire structure of our theology. Sproul raises a fascinating hypothetical at this point, though it's not one he himself adopts. He notes how someone perhaps could argue that Scripture's elevation as the sole and final authority does not carry with it the necessary inference that it is inerrant. One might believe, for example, that popes, councils, and Scripture all err, but nevertheless, Scripture is the first among equals. He says, or Scripture could be regarded as carrying unique authority solely on the basis of its being the primary historical source of the gospel. Now, either way, Sola Scriptura is affirmed in this approach, but not because Scripture is perfect, but rather because it is primary, either in quality or in its origin. Now, I want to make two points of clarification here. Number one, in regards to this approach, this was not the historic position of the Reformers, no matter what anyone tells you. Scripture was the sole and final authority not because it was the best of all errant authorities or because it came first, but because its supremacy was derivative of its perfection as divine revelation. I don't know that I can emphasize this point enough. But secondly, it's doubtful that such a person and such an approach is actually affirming Sola Scriptura. And here I place the emphasis on the word sola. Now, why is this the case? Perhaps for him, Scripture, popes, and councils all err. Nevertheless, Scripture is the supreme authority because it is the only one of the three that is from God as divine revelation. Scripture for him is the first among errant sources. But let me ask you, does this solve the problem for the limited inerrantist? Has he found a way to affirm Sola Scriptura even though he rejects the full inerrancy of Scripture? I think the answer is no. Again, the reason why is found at least in part in the definition and the historic Reformation understanding of Sola Scriptura itself. As mentioned, for reformers like Luther and Calvin and others, to say that Scripture is the sole and final source of authority is an incomplete explanation and definition in defense of Sola Scriptura. Sola Scriptura must mean that Scripture is the sole and final inerrant source of authority. If we take out its perfection and that word inerrant, we no longer have the doctrine of Sola Scriptura in its totality. Perhaps this point is best seen in an explicit contrast between the two. On the one hand, we have the full inerrancy view, which says all of Scripture is our inerrant authority. On the other hand, we have the limited inerrancy view, which says only when Scripture addresses matters of faith is it our inerrant authority. Which one is affirming Sola Scriptura? I think it's the full inerrancy position. Why? Because the limited inerrancy view can only consistently utilize Sola Scriptura when it believes Scripture's main spiritual message of the Bible is in view. However, in other areas where it errs, Scripture is neither inerrant nor authoritative, nor sufficient. The point is this, those errant parts of Scripture don't fall under the banner of Sola Scriptura. Indeed, they cannot. Where the Bible is misguided and wrong, it is impossible for it to then speak authoritative and sufficiently on matters it addresses erroneously. Why would we listen, let alone obey, those parts of the Bible we believe are in error and will somehow mislead us? While the limited inerrantist might appeal to other parts of the Bible, the true parts that is, he is inconsistent to appeal to the errant parts as thus says the Lord passages. Why? Whether he will acknowledge it or not, I think it's because authority and sufficiency are naturally bound up with inspiration and inerrancy. Should one be compromised, the others will follow. And therefore, the limited inerrantist not only limits inerrancy, but Sola Scriptura as well. Or to state it more precisely, it's because he limits inerrancy that he must also limit Sola Scriptura. The two are inseparable, and where one is adjusted, so must the other be adjusted. But not so for the full inerrantist. All of Scripture is authoritative, precisely because all of Scripture is God-breathed, and therefore necessarily inerrant. So the key question for us remains, can the limited inerrantist claim the doctrine of Sola Scriptura? I think, and I believe I've tried to demonstrate, the answer must be no, because in limiting inerrancy, one must necessarily limit authority if you are at least going to be consistent. Now, we need to press this a little bit deeper before we move on. What is one limiting inerrancy to? What is one limiting Scripture's authority to? Typically, one is limiting its authority to the main salvific message of the Bible. So it's incredibly difficult, you might argue impossible, for the limited inerrantist to affirm Sola Scriptura, since this doctrine means that Scripture is the sole and final flawless authority in all that it addresses. If he is to affirm Sola Scriptura, he must significantly modify the meaning of Sola Scriptura to something like this. Scripture is the sole and final authority as far as it is inerrant. And therefore, for the full inerrantist, inerrancy and authority extend to all of Scripture, but for the limited inerrantist, inerrancy and authority extend to certain parts of Scripture. And consequently, for the full inerrantist, there is no limit to the canon sufficiency, because there is no limit to its perfection. But for the limited inerrantist, the sufficiency of the canon is limited to those places where it is perfect. It's in that light that such a stance by the limited inerrantist presents several additional problems. I want you to consider a few of these. They're so important. First, since the limited inerrantist has limited Scripture's perfection and therefore its authority, Scripture must be supplemented. Scripture is not enough. The perfection and authority of Scripture have been restricted, remember? There has been what we could call a canon reduction. And therefore, where Scripture is lacking in perfection and authority, there must be a supplemental authority to take its place, whether it be reason, experience, tradition, or science. But this path, I would argue, is not an evangelical one. Moreover, should we travel down this path, we have now elevated ourselves and our own reason above Scripture. For example, once one declares that Scripture is an error, such a declaration reveals that he, not Scripture, now stands above the Bible. He is now the superior authority, acting as judge, declaring the verdict. Unfortunately, this is exactly what the position of the limited inerrantists, this is the exact position they have taken, declaring which parts are acceptable and which parts are not. But the very meaning of Sola Scriptura precludes such a stance. If Scripture is truly our supreme authority, then ipso facto no one, and I mean no one, can stand over and above Scripture as judge. The minute we do so, we have removed the sola from Scriptura, and we have placed our own human reason there instead. So in summary, we simply cannot say that Scripture is our supreme authority. Our supreme authority. And simultaneously judge, as a limited inerrantist does, certain parts of Scripture as untrustworthy, unreliable, and errant. If we do, we have now become the supreme final authority, not Scripture. There's a second point I want you to pay attention to. Canon reduction is not a sustainable option for evangelicals. If we limit inerrancy to some parts of Scripture but not others, we have two questions that naturally arise. First, what parts of Scripture are inerrant and therefore authoritative, and what parts are not? Second, who gets to determine what parts of Scripture are inerrant and therefore authoritative, and what parts are not? To answer the first question, limited inerrantists will respond by saying that those parts of Scripture that are necessary for our salvation are inerrant and authoritative. But this presents more problems than solutions, doesn't it? To begin with, how much must we know to be saved? Surely this opens the door for those who would answer, very little. And if it's very little, then very little of the Bible may be actually inerrant. Additionally, it's hard to avoid the conclusion that we are now seeking to create a canon within a canon. In light of the long history of Protestant liberalism, how do we avoid then the practice of throwing away the husk of Scripture in order to find that kernel? For limited inerrantists, usually, if not always, the husk ends up being the historical or perhaps the scientific data, while the kernel concerns matters related to the main message of Scripture, matters of faith and practice, they would say. However, Scripture never divorces faith from history, the spiritual from the historical. In fact, when we look at the big picture of the Bible, what we see is that all of redemption is rooted in history, from Adam to the last Adam, from Eden to the New Jerusalem. It's called redemptive history for a reason. And therefore, we cannot bifurcate matters of faith from matters of history. The two go hand in hand. And if we do so, Scripture no longer is the determining norm, but our human reason has taken on that role. And in the end, it's the individual who is now deciding what parts are from God and what parts are not. In essence, we have removed the sola from Scriptura. Finally, the limited inerrantist viewpoint is misleading with its macro emphasis on the Bible. We have to be careful here. We don't want to deny the distinction between primary and secondary, fundamental and non-fundamental matters in Scripture. Indeed, one could go so far as to say that not every passage is directly or explicitly soteriological in nature. Distinctions like these have historically aided Christians and councils in determining what does and does not count as heresy. However, in no way should these distinctions then lead us to conclude that the Bible is only inerrant in its fundamental or soteriological aspects. This is a terrible misuse of these theological categories. I demonstrate this throughout my book, but Jesus and his apostles approached all of the Old Testament as the very Word of God, having an attitude of total trust and confidence. Jesus and his apostles not only trusted the soteriological or the macro message of the Old Testament, but they assumed in every way the reliability of its secondary details, even those historical in nature. In other words, they understood all of it to be trustworthy and true. I love what Greg Bonson has to say. It is impossible to maintain the theological principle of sola scriptura on the basis of limited inerrancy for an errant authority being in need of correction by some outside source cannot serve as the only source and judge of Christian theology. Well, you've been very patient, and so I'm going to conclude with one final challenge, which will be much shorter, to sola scriptura. The second challenge comes today from the realm of science. And even that statement, I hesitate to say it because it's not quite accurate, is it? For it gives the impression that Christianity and science are enemies. So perhaps it's more precise to say that this second challenge today comes from those who would elevate science as the authoritative status to the authoritative status of Scripture itself. Now, I want to be really clear from the start. Science is a magnificent means through which our reason explores the natural order, makes discoveries, and if it's done rightly, leads us, as Psalm 19 says so well, it leads us to worship our Creator. And so, sola scriptura, as J.I. Packer warns, should not entail a Bible without science mentality, as sometimes is evident in the worst forms of the fundamentalist movement. However, today there is a tendency among evangelicals, whether they realize it or not, to elevate science above Scripture, or at least to a place of equal authority. Science, in other words, is just as authoritative as Scripture, and therefore should be followed in its findings, even if those findings conflict with Scripture. In such a view, Scripture is to be interpreted through the grid of science, not vice versa. Should science and Scripture meet an impasse, Scripture, not science, must be either rejected or reconfigured. Now, this isn't the place to rehearse the long and ongoing debate over evolution since Darwin, but we really should draw attention to ways in which the Bible's authority can be compromised at the expense of adopting evolutionary claims. The 21st century and the 20th century has proven that like-minded Christians have disagreed over evolution. Some evangelicals reject evolution entirely as incompatible with who God is and how the Bible says he created the universe, while others seek to somehow retain theism and reconcile it with an evolutionary view of origins, though one initiated and guided by God. Today, the debate has now escalated over whether or not Adam was a historical person, though this is actually a very historical debate as well. For our purposes, what must be noted is that some have gone so far as to conclude, in light of evolution, the biblical authors were wrong in assuming and affirming a historical Adam. Take Peter Enns, for example, who thinks it's a fool's errand to try and reconcile evolution with what the biblical authors say about Adam. He says these two are incompatible and at odds, and instead he says we must realize that Paul was mistaken. As a first century man with a primitive view of the cosmos, Paul naturally thought that Adam was a historical person. But we know now, in light of centuries of scientific inquiry, and we could read evolution into that sentence, that this cannot be the case. And here I'm not quoting him, I'm paraphrasing his writings. Enns's we now know better approach, as I would call it, which itself is very much a remnant of the Enlightenment, has led him to give up the doctrine of inerrancy, and not only on a small matter, but on something as important as the historicity of Adam. Others approach the Bible with a similar hermeneutic. For example, Kenton Sparks believes there is a trajectory in Scripture whereby more recent revelation, the New Testament, corrects older revelation, the Old Testament, because it's an error. Sparks believes evangelicals are wrong to assume that the Bible has a unified theology. Notice, by the way, how this is moving just from details to the theology of the Bible. It's wrong that it has a unified theology. Instead, he says there is a diversity of theologies at play, and many of these theologies are at odds with one another. Our job, therefore, is to move beyond the Bible and be open to other authorities, especially scientific voices, even if they contradict what we read in Scripture. For Sparks, then, the Bible is full of errors, and not just factual ones, but ethical and doctrinal ones as well. Some even misrepresenting God himself. As a result, we must look outside of the Bible to fields like science to correct Scripture's primitive anthropology. We must come to grips with the reality that science even trumps the Bible's teaching. Ends and Sparks are just a few examples of those who have rejected not only total inerrancy, but as a result, Scripture's full sufficiency and authority. They're honest. The Bible just gets it wrong, cannot be followed, and it's not enough. Something more is needed, in this case, science. When the Bible collides with science, it's the Bible that must give way. As a consequence, Sola Scriptura is undermined, and with it, the authority and sufficiency of God's Word. Where the Christian should follow the Bible becomes a game of pick and choose. For one person, the Bible's affirmation of historical Adam must go. But for another, it's the Bible's stance against homosexuality. And yet for another, it's Christ's deity or his resurrection. This approach has a long history, and it's hard to see how it avoids, at the end of the day, postmodern subjectivism, making each individual his own hermeneutical lord. In the end, science, when done rightly, I would argue, always conforms to the truths of Scripture. Science, in and of itself, is not an enemy of Scripture. Indeed, science serves to brilliantly support Christianity at times. Science only becomes problematic when we misuse it and draw false conclusions, conclusions that are incompatible with the truths of God's Word. But like tradition during the 16th century, today we must understand science's role as ministerial rather than magisterial. Though we apply it in light of new challenges today, we must return to Luther, Calvin, and Zwingli, and many others who said that Scripture alone is our norming norm rather than the determined or the ruled norm. Because Scripture alone is our inspired, inerrant, and is our sufficient and final authority. So, in conclusion, where do we go from here? One might assume that with the Reformation's recovery of Sola Scriptura, Protestantism, well, it overcame all obstacles and forever sailed smoothly into the sunset. History, though, tells us a very different story, in fact, a very stormy one. While Luther and Calvin may have overcome Rome's papalism in the 16th century, at least we Protestants like to think so, with the advent of modernism, rationalistic biblical criticism produced a new papalism, the infallibility of the biblical scholar, who provides the world with his assured results. What did this new papalism look like? It planted seeds of doubt throughout the biblical text, so that one began to wonder whether he was reading divine revelation at all. Whereas previously the reader distrusted himself, approaching the text with reverence and hermeneutical humility, now the reader approached the text as its Lord and judge. What was the outcome? The words of the prophet Amos became real once again. There was a spiritual famine in the land, a famine of the Word of God. There arose a spiritual deafness as men no longer would listen to the Bible as God's speech. Rationalistic criticism dug a ditch separating man's witness to God's Word from revelation itself, and one dare not cross this ditch. God's Word was one thing, says J.I. Packer, but Holy Scripture was another. The Bible was now a mere collection of fallible books, and the Augustinian heritage of the past, which believed that what Scripture says is what God says, it was discarded. It was now the scholar's obligation to save the Bible by ridding it of any theological beliefs or assumptions that were out of line with modern scientific methods. In the 21st century, One might be relieved to think that those days are behind us. But are they really? Or do remnants of such an approach to the Bible continue today, arguing that until inspiration and inerrancy are disposed of, the Bible will never be truly set free, let alone understood? If the answer is yes, then how do we as evangelicals committed to biblical authority move forward? How do we take strides that don't compromise Sola Scriptura, but instead celebrate it in all of its beauty and complexity? Well, we must be honest. We must be honest about our approach to the Bible. No longer can our starting point be the individual, as if we are the judge that stands above Scripture. Whether it be the Enlightenment with its reliance upon autonomous reason, liberalism with its elevation of man's experience, or postmodernism, which has turned Scripture into a wax nose. The individual, not God's Word, has taken center stage, calling the shots, claiming to be the determining norm. In contrast, Sola Scriptura means we begin by listening to what Scripture has to say about itself. For it claims an authority that comes from God as opposed to one that comes from man. Rather than imposing a modern or postmodern agenda upon the text, we must have an open ear to the biblical categories that Scripture itself provides in order to guide us in its interpretation. Such an approach seeks to acknowledge the self-authenticating nature of Scripture. In other words, we are seeking to ground authority in the greatest authority that we can possibly find, namely Scripture itself. For in doing so, we are actually grounding Scripture's authority in God. For He is its divine author, and it is His Word. As Calvin said, God alone is a fit witness of Himself in His Word. Scripture indeed is self-authenticated. Sola Scriptura, Scripture alone, this formal principle, to echo Warfield, lies at the foundation of our Christian faith and is nothing less than fundamental to our Christian hope. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Barrett. That was very, very good, and appreciate the clarity. Are we on here? Testing? Yes, there we go. Yes, thank you so very much. And again, we'll invite people. There's a microphone up here. Maybe, Oren, just move it over in the middle of the aisle there a bit and raise it if you would. If you have questions, make your way up here, and I'll do as I have in the past, begin with one, if that's all right. But please feel free to come on up and be ready to ask a question. You know, this was a very interesting paper for me personally to hear you present. The ghost of Jack Rogers was in the room with me. Jack Rogers was my supervisor at Fuller Seminary. He was the Rogers McKim book that came out in the early 80s. And when I went to Fuller as a doctoral student, I didn't have to do this, but I sat in on Jack Rogers' classes because I wanted to hear him make his case against inerrancy, because he was known really on campus for the anti-inerrancy guy and also the pro-egalitarian. Of course, they all were that, but he was kind of in a big way pro-egalitarian also. So I sat in on Jack's classes, and I remember one of his arguments that I think had it was one argument that had significant impact on students to persuade them of his view. And it went something like this. It does relate to your last part of your paper that you did with science. He said, "Would anyone want to dispute that biblical authors had a primitive cosmology?" In other words, do we want to say that God granted Moses a Copernican worldview? And I, you know, so he assumes that that they thought of the world, that is Moses and other biblical writers thought of the world just as other contemporaries of their time thought of the world. So he said, then his next point was this, then if we look for the intended meaning of the author in the text of Scripture as it relates to cosmology, wouldn't we have to say that that intended meaning would reflect a worldview that we now know is incorrect? Therefore, the Scriptures in those areas of science would have to be seen as errant. So that's the argument that he presented, and I think many, many students heard that and found it persuasive. I'm curious how you respond to that. I have my own response, too. I thought about this for many, many years, so yes, please.
Well, your response may be much better than mine, but I'll give it a try. This is a very common argument, and it's used often. It continues today. I mean, we think that some of these views are dead and long gone. They're not. A couple of thoughts come to mind. First of all, we have to keep in mind that when we're talking about the language of the Bible, oftentimes students and even scholars will confuse precision with truth. Now, maybe that's confusing. What does that mean? Precision and truth are not necessarily the same thing. They may overlap with one another. So in fields like mathematics and science, there tends to be more of an overlap between precision and truth. But in many other fields, in how we even use our language, that's not the case, is it? In other words, what I'm warning against is approaching the Bible as if this is an encyclopedia or textbook for a science class. And what happens at that point, which is I think some of the mistakes they make, is because it doesn't add up to our scientific methods in the 21st century of scientific precision, we assume it's full of errors. Many have made this argument, but it's important to point out that does that force on the Bible a terrible hermeneutical grid, as if we're assuming that this is some type of textbook. In reality, we haven't done justice to all the genres in the Scripture that speak in different ways. And so we, even in our own language today, which is, I think, at times what the biblical authors are doing, they are using language from our vantage point, not to be precise, but to explain to the readers truth. So, for example, if I say to you, what time is it right now? And you were to answer me, well, 10:30. If I was to then respond to you and say, you've lied, you're in error, would that be a proper response? Probably not. Why? Because in our language, what are we doing? It's practically 10:30, isn't it? So precision and truth may overlap at points, but they don't necessarily have to. And at times, we can even be imprecise with our language and still be speaking truthfully with our language. At times, I think this is what the biblical authors are doing. They are, we talk about the sun setting. Are we in error? Are we making some major fallacy? Well, to say that we are is to act as if we're in a lab and all language has to be scientifically precise. But no, we're not in error. We are describing the world very much as God has given it from our perception. So there's many more things that could be said. I'd be curious to hear, did you respond to him in that classroom?
Oh, no, I was thinking. I mean, I was being faced with this and gave a lot of thought, talked to Tom Schreiner, who was at Fuller with me, and we, this was a a long process to think through these things. So, but yeah, I mean, eventually, I think the way that you are going with this is very helpful in that recognizing that we all speak phenomenologically. We speak experientially. We even who know better say sunset, sunrise. Mm. You know, and when we know that's not technically what happens, but it's also, I think it's also helpful to remember that that we wouldn't want to say of Moses or any other biblical writer that because they write under inspiration, that means that every wrong idea they have is corrected. They are filled with mistaken ideas about lots of things. But what guarantees that this is the Word of God is that when they write under inspiration, they write led by the Holy Spirit exactly correctly. That doesn't mean they are exactly correct in everything they think. It means they are exactly correct in what they write under inspiration. Those are two very different things. Right. And that would apply to anything that relates to their views of cosmology as well. Mm-hmm. And then you couple with that the observation that they're not writing to teach you cosmology. That's not the point. They're reflecting on experientially what they understand, yeah. And they're reflecting that accurately in terms of how we experience the world and so on. But anyway, that's very helpful, Matthew. Thank you.
I like your response better.
No. It's very helpful. Thank you. Okay, other questions, please. We're going to yield to a fellow speaker here. Come on up, Dr. Van Druden. Yes, please.
Thank you for the lecture. What I would like to ask you about relates somewhat to the questions about science, but yeah. I would like to ask your thoughts, especially on the relation of the authority of natural revelation to the doctrine of Sola Scriptura. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people, when they hear Sola Scriptura, they think or would say, well, that it somehow implies we don't need natural revelation, or that natural revelation is not that important. And what I sometimes like to say is that Sola Scriptura means that we don't need other sources of special revelation. We don't need an infallible magisterium in Rome. We don't need new prophets coming and giving us new revelations from God. But Sola Scriptura was never meant historically to say we don't need natural revelation. In fact, it would be impossible to read Scripture apart from the knowledge of the natural world. Scripture in so many ways presumes that we have a certain knowledge of this world. So I guess I'd be curious to hear some thoughts from you about how we can robustly affirm the truthfulness and authority of natural revelation while maintaining that robust doctrine of Sola Scriptura that you're advocating.
Yeah, I mean, I think what you said, David, is right on target. You think of a passage like Psalm 19, and there are others, which talk about the created order. And here you have this reflection on the beauty of nature and very much general revelation. And yet at the same time, it's coming to us as special revelation in Scripture. So I think that you make a really important qualification. We need to make sure that when we are explaining Sola Scriptura, we're not going maybe in the direction of some neo-Orthodox in which they have said, well, no general revelation at all. I think that would be a mistake. At the same time, we have to be careful of the other extreme. We don't want to divorce general revelation or nature from Scripture as if it's a standalone means by, I mean, this happened in the Enlightenment period, as if it's a standalone means by which we don't need anything else. I mean, that direction then would abandon Sola Scriptura as well. So we have to be careful of those two problems. How do we approach general revelation? Well, there's a couple of things to keep in mind. First of all, general revelation is really revelation from God. It's good. And it's an important means that he has given to us. At the same time, we have to remember our context, which comes from Scripture and the storyline of Scripture. We are finite beings, and we are also fallen beings. We live in a post-Genesis 3 world. And because of those things, we need a word from God that is much more detailed and much more saving than anything general revelation could ever offer to us. General revelation does not give us the gospel. It doesn't provide us with those saving truths. And so general revelation, we don't want to not deny it, but at the same time, we need to, and I guess we could say, put it under the umbrella of Scripture itself. The two are never to contradict each other. In fact, they should be compatible with one another. They're both God's revelations. At the same time, God has given us his written word, which is what Sola Scriptura gets at. And that's why many times in my talk, I would, not always, but I would sometimes throw in the word written, because I didn't want to deny general revelation. I want to convey that Sola Scriptura means that Scripture is our perfect, sufficient, authoritative source of written revelation. It's an important qualification to make. So I'm not sure if I've answered all of your question, David, but there's probably much more to be said, but hopefully that gets at some of it.
Thank you. One more, I think. Yes, please.
Joseph Yu, thank you so much for your talk. This has been very helpful, and I really appreciate it. On the self-authenticating nature of Scripture, we as inerrantists hold that, you know, what Calvin said in the Institute, saying that Scripture authenticates itself, thus saith the Lord. You know, we see that the Bible testifies about itself as the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit indwelling in Christians affirms that and authenticates that as well, which means that we know the Bible's Word of God because of the self-authenticating nature and the testimony of the Spirit. However, my question is twofold. What would Peter Enns and other limited inerrantists, how would they respond to that? And second, wouldn't they say that we as inerrantists are imposing our own hermeneutics, just as we would say that they are imposing their own understanding, thus having authority over Scripture? Thank you.
Yeah, they would. They would. Which is, again, it just comes back to Sola Scriptura. How do we answer that? Well, we check ourselves against Scripture itself, right? We all have presuppositions. We all have certain biases, whether you realize it or not, whether they're cultural, they could even be theological, that we come to Scripture with. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. Sometimes we think we can come to Scripture totally neutral. It's not possible. We all have presuppositions that we approach the text with. So we're not denying that. We're not saying, oh, you know, those who deny inerrancy or the truthfulness of Scripture, you know, you guys are imposing something on Scripture, and we have this perfect hermeneutical, you know, pair of glasses in which we can look at Scripture. I mean, if we do that, then we could be giving into the temptation of just falling back into an Enlightenment mindset. How do we remedy that? Well, I think what you mentioned is exactly how we remedy that, word and spirit. In fact, the emblem on this podium is a visible picture of that, isn't it? You have the Word of God. So there's the self-authenticating nature of Scripture. Scripture itself speaks volumes about its own character, and it flows right out of the character of God. And at the same time, and I think this avoids that Enlightenment temptation, at the same time, the Holy Spirit, here we see in the form of a dove, is what? Descending upon the Word of God. Why? Why is that so necessary? Well, in the 16th century, some of the radicals, they would go to one extreme or the other. Either an overemphasis on the Spirit, as Carl talked about, or just a very rationalistic approach to the Spirit. Calvin put this so well. He said, Scripture is self-authenticating, and we need the Holy Spirit. We are dependent upon the Holy Spirit to come and to illuminate the Scriptures for us. So we're not claiming to somehow be able in and of ourselves to have the right interpretation or the right reading of the Word of God. No, we are coming to Scripture with hermeneutical humility. Not as lords, but as servants, listening to what Scripture says. That's a self-authenticating nature. And then, well, simultaneously, really, praying. I always tell those in my church, pray that the Spirit would be with you, and as you're reading the Word of God, would help you to understand it. Now, to be clear, this isn't more revelation or another act of inspiration. We need to distinguish inspiration from illumination. But what we are praying for is exactly that, the illumination of the Holy Spirit to open our blind eyes so that we see the text. So the short answer would be, when someone gives you that objection, I would say to them, yes, I'm a fallible human being. I can, and perhaps there have been times in the past when I have read Scripture wrongly, and I need to be corrected. However, I am submitting myself to the words of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. And where I find myself in error, I come back to the Scripture and allow it to correct me.
Amen. Thank you. I think we'll cut it off right here, but you can come up and ask a question afterwards.